here. We were getting our makeup done, and the makeup woman said, "You two look like you're ready for the morgue." And she almost—they almost buried us right then and there. But we did. We're still surviving. But you look good. Look at you.
Okay. Look at you.
Look at you. Am I annoying you already?
You need a haircut. Okay. First, let's clear up the thing about Emily, your daughter.
Okay.
She quit the Broadway Jewish play called Kabbalah. The cast included her. She appeared naked. What's the story?
Big story today in the newspaper. I opened up the pages, and there was my beautiful daughter in the newspaper. My daughter Emily is my oldest daughter. She's 22 years old, and she's a great kid. And she's an aspiring actress, and I'm extremely proud of her. And she, you know, she's 22, in charge of her own career, and it's certainly gratifying to me to see her doing well. And she, you know, went and did a show. I was unaware of the show. I'm not a, I haven't seen the show. Don't know too much about the show. But, you know, she, it's her prerogative. What she wants to do, she does. And
she's Madonna, right?
Yeah, she calls the shots in her own career. And, you know, evidently, she had some falling out with the director of the thing. And I've spoken to her since about it. And it's, you know, it's all rather unfortunate because she's a, you know, she's a great kid, and like so many people trying to get started in acting, you know, put her faith, from what she tells me, she put her faith in the director and the cast, and had a wonderful cast, but kind of made a deal with the director that he wouldn't use her picture for promotional purposes and wouldn't single her out. They kind of had a verbal agreement, and she felt very betrayed by this guy. And, you know, I said to her, I think it's a dangerous business in that in any business you can get, you know, taken advantage by
she
people.
She quit because she thought nude pictures of her would appear on the website?
No, she quit. It was a big misunderstanding. From what she tells me, she quit because the guy who runs the production promised her not to use her pictures, promoting her and single her out as Howard Stern's daughter, Emily Stern. And she felt very, very betrayed and lied to. And, you know, listen, I said to her, there's going to be a lot of people out there who are jealous of you along the way and jealous of, you know, your father's career and this kind of stuff. Had nothing to do with nudity or anything like that. It had to do with a an assurance.
If she chose to be nude, that would be fine with you? And
yeah, in fact, I have no problem with nudity. It's and it wasn't an issue of nudity. That wasn't the issue. She made a deal with a guy, and he betrayed her, so she left. And then, so unfortunately, he's gone to the newspaper, you know, looking for some fame and to comment on her. But, you know, I'm so proud of her. I'm telling you, she's a great kid, and we have a great relationship, and she's a fine actress. And by the way, many actresses have appeared nude on stage. I told her that. You know, Nicole Kidman's been there a couple of times.
Is it hard to be your daughter, you think?
Sure. I think there's some advantage to it. But I also think in a kid trying to find her own identity, it's got to be rough. She's got a father who's very infamous, and certainly I'm out there, and I'm a wild guy. And I would think it would be difficult to figure out who you are in life and all of that. And I think she's done a beautiful job of it.
How did you become Howard Stern? How did you develop this persona?
Well, you know, I've made no secret of the fact that I've always wanted to be on radio. I can remember being 5 years old. And, you know, it goes back. My father was a recording engineer. I've told you this before. And my father used to look at Don Adams and Larry Storch and some of the great voice guys doing cartoons and commercials. And I would go down to my father's studio. Once in a while, he'd bring me. And I'd watch his eyes, and he would stare at these guys, and he would have such reverence for the greats. You know, these guys were great. And I would watch these guys working, and I said, oh, my God, you know, if my father looked at me like that, he'd be so proud of me. And I think early on when I saw that microphone, and I remember to this day, I was a kid, and Don Adams was recording Tennessee Tuxedo, a commercial, a cartoon. And he's standing there in a blazer and a turtleneck, and he looks so damn suave to me. You know, this is before Maxwell Smart. And I saw my father looking at him, and I went, wow, you know, I want to do something like this. And I didn't listen to a lot of radio growing up. I can only remember one guy, Brad Crandall, I used to listen to at night.
Great voice.
Yeah, it was just this guy.
But how did you carry it on to become what you become, to take it to the fullest extent? No, you didn't draw any middle ground.
Well, it was a process. I mean, I When I was in college radio, I did a show called the King Schmaltz Bagel Hour. It was me and three guys, and it was very irreverent. And it had always been my fantasy to go on radio and not do a straight broadcast, but to bring the audience into sort of my thought process. I remember listening to the radio, and you'd hear a guy close a door in the background on a news station, or you'd hear a cart or something drop on the floor. And you'd go, what the hell is that? And they wouldn't tell you. They'd act like it wasn't going on. And I kind of had this fantasy that I'd create a radio show where I'd tell you everything. Everything about me, everything about it. Whoever walked in, complete honesty. We strip away all barriers. And this was my thing. And I went in college radio, and I started this. And I got fired after the third show. We did a bit called Godzilla Goes to Harlem. And you know, no one ever heard anything like this. And it was a college radio station, Carrier Current. And we did this thing, and I got fired right on the air. And that was sort of an omen of what was to come. And my father wrote me a letter, and he said to me, you know, it's great that you're on the air and all of that, but I listen to the tape, and you go, every minute, and you fumfer on the air, and you don't sound professional, and you're not enunciating. And he said, even a clown probably was a trained ballet dancer or something, and you need to go out and do a straight radio show. And in my opinion, learn how to, you know, do radio.
Good advice.
It was really good advice. And I went, and I did a straight show for 2 years, and I was awful. It was chronicled in my movie. And I said, you know what, though? It was the best 2 years of my life. I had to do everything at that station. And I kept dreaming in my head of breaking sort of all the walls down, all those straight walls down. And someone asked me the other day, gee, did you ever think about doing like a Larry King show? They said, you're a very good interviewer. Interviewing is a strength of yours. And I said, that's a career that wasn't for me. I wanted to expose myself and expose every, so I didn't want to have any secrets from the audience.
I like the guest. You like you. Well, you want the show to be into you.
No, that's not it. That's not what I'm saying. So, you know, the guy who replaced me in New York, David Lee Roth, I listened to his first show, and he said, hey man, this ain't heavy lifting. This radio stuff is easy. And I was thinking about that, and I thought, no, radio isn't easy. It's easy, yeah, sure, anyone can go on the air and talk, but to open yourself up and actually break down all the walls and think about all of your insecurities and put those on the air, I think it isn't easy lifting. There's a lot of emotional lifting you have to do. But having said that, when a guest comes in, I think the reason people might think I'm a good interviewer is that I'm genuinely curious about a person. I don't make judgments. If somebody's a stripper, that's great. If someone's a prostitute, you know, Robin, who works with me, she decided to work with me. She heard a tape of me in Detroit. I was interviewing a prostitute. And she said to me, when I heard you do it, you asked her everything, what she ate for breakfast, why she went to the store, you know, who were her parents, how did she get into this sort of miserable life? And you didn't make judgments. And that's what the show has always been about. I myself don't really have outrageous behavior, I don't think. But I'm a voyeur. I like to watch outrageous behavior, and I like to learn about outrageous behavior.
Howard Stern's our guest. Monday's a big day in his life. We'll talk about that right after this.
Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest radio performer of all time, Howard Stern!
I want you to experience radio the way I think it should be, the future of radio. Sirius satellite radio will dominate the medium. It is the death of FM radio, the death of the FCC interference, the death of the FCC. Down with the FCC.
By the way, your lovely girlfriend, fiance is here. Are you married? Married?
We went away to Mexico for a week after I got off, you know, regular old boring radio. After I left dumpy commercial loaded radio, my girlfriend and I went to Mexico together, and we had a great time relaxing for the week before I was coming back to get ready, you know, for the big launch on January 9th. And it was written in the New York Post that we got married while we were away in Mexico. And being P.T. Barnum, I went ahead and said, I will answer the questions about my marriage on January 9th on Sirius Satellite Radio.
Hooking Larry, in more of listeners.
pulling in more listeners. That's the game. You know, I have tremendous insecurity. I would like, you wouldn't believe it looking at me, but yeah. But I would like everybody who used to listen to me to come over with me. And maybe that's an impossible dream, but that's my dream. I think people will have a great time.
But when you say my marriage, you have already hinted that you got married.
And maybe I'm smart enough to sort of lead you in that direction. You see, I'm doing a mislead. So you're going to have to, let me tell you about the first show. Because people say, what's the first show?
This is Monday morning,
Monday
5
morning,
o'clock,
January.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock.
Eastern.
We have something planned that I think is going to be great for my fans. And that's the great thing about satellite. We no longer have to sit and worry about programming to the masses.
FCC don't care.
FCC, we don't care. Religious right, government interference, gone.
Okay. First day.
First day, we are doing a revelation show. Each one of us, each one of the major cast members, has agreed to reveal something about themselves that we've never revealed on the air and that has to meet a certain standard.
Which is,
we put a guy in charge. We each had to go into a confessional booth and confess our sin or secret or something that humiliated us or embarrassed us. And if it didn't measure up, we had to go back and come up with something else.
Had to be humiliating.
No, doesn't have to be humiliating. Might be something that we didn't want to share. Could be a secret.
Might have a disease.
Could be a disease. Could be that dreaded disease that you have. I might get it too. You know, you don't know. But Larry, so this is dangerous radio for me. This is a high wire. Because I went into the confessional, I admitted what it is, and the guy said, whoa. And that whoa, it was what I'm looking for. So we've got some good stuff. I do have to address whether or not Beth and I got married. You know, there's plenty on the table. We just left this huge radio experience. Probably the most successful radio show in the history of radio. And walking away from that, I have to tell you that I had no emotional experience about it until the day after when I woke up. I woke up and I realized I'll never hit that button again and have that kind of access. Millions and millions and millions of fans.
Now, this is your first public appearance since then,
That's
since
right.
leaving.
Right.
And you go on the new one Monday.
Right.
Are you scared?
Well, I don't feel scared. Maybe a little bit, because I don't want to disappoint people. And I have to tell you, we've done two run-throughs this week. And this is the great thing about having your own channel. All of a sudden, I said, when we're doing the run-through, just pop on the run-through. So in essence, we've been on twice already. And whoever was driving in the car, all of a sudden, we just popped on the radio. And that's fun. And the run-through was liberating. I had the most amazing radio experience New Year's Eve. And I'll tell you why satellite's great and why every broadcaster should be involved in this. New Year's Eve, they said, it's the first time your voice can be heard on your own channel. I was out of my contract with Viacom. Would you call in? And I said, I don't know if I'm up. Went out, had a bunch of drinks, fell asleep. But at midnight, I heard fireworks coming out of the park. And it woke me up. And I said, oh, what the hell? I'll just call in. I started talking stream of consciousness into this telephone receiver, kind of drunk, you know, a little bit hungover, and I've never had that kind of freedom before. I didn't use any foul language. It wasn't about that. I didn't have to worry about the constraints, what topics I could talk about. I didn't worry about the, you know, average quarter hour maintenance, crossing the quarter hour, how many listeners I had. Whoever was there, it was fine with me. And it was the most intimate radio I've ever done, just talking into that receiver.
What do you think about the gamble that they're taking serious? That's a heavy load it's been printed. It's no secret that you're getting a ton of money.
Right.
They're giving you even more in stock deals, etc. You're wealthy forever.
I've heard that I'm either going to have $200 million, $500 million. Today I heard $600 million, and I still don't have any paycheck from them.
But so you know they're rolling a lot
of chips. I'm waiting for this money.
They're rolling a lot of chips.
Yes.
Does that give you pressure?
You know, it did. So I signed the contract in 2005, a year ago. And, you know, it was weird. They had 600,000 people listening to Sirius Satellite Radio. And I would have to say, out of the two satellite services, Sirius was really not sort of in the forefront.
Way behind XM.
Yeah.
There's only two.
And I signed the deal. And, you know, right away they said, you've got to get 1 million people to come with you if this thing is going to be profitable.
Sign up for the service.
That's right. So, you know, who knows what it's going to be, but I have the loyalest fans in the world. You know, I put out a movie, they showed up, a book, whatever it is I've done, and I don't think I've ever betrayed my audience. I've always delivered to them the best product I could deliver, possibly, that I could deliver, and I think they appreciated that. Well, lo and behold, so here we are a year later. I haven't done my first broadcast yet, and today they announced 3.3 million people have signed up. So we fought today, that was the announcement. 3.3 and growing. Haven't hit the air yet.
What do they pay a month?
It's $12.95,
and so I can. They made it back.
They've made it back in spades.
Yeah.
So people say, well, is it a are you a loser? Is this a lose-lose situation? I go, lose. I can't. You know, I can't imagine a loss in this. My fans are coming with me. I'm free to do the kind of radio I want. I am happier than I've ever been. The studios are beautiful.
Yeah, they are. I've been up there.
Gorgeous. And you know, the only thing that's different is I'm starting something new. And in order to start something new, I had to give something up. I had to give up the thrill of hitting the button on terrestrial radio. But I was done with terrestrial. I was dead in the water.
Let me ask you about that, too. Ted Turner did it here.
Sure.
I had to take those guys, roll the risk.
Do you ever feel like a loser for leaving radio and coming here?
Never.
Never. I mean, that's how I feel.
We'll take a break. Be right back with Howard Stern. We'll also be including your phone calls. Don't go away.
So you're doing good.
I'm doing good. I'm doing good.
I love you.
Do you want to propose? Should we all leave?
I propose.
Yeah. Do I need to get married again? I don't know.
You do, to me.
Especially, you know, if you're not going to just, you just need to be madly crazy, wildly in love, and that's the only reason really to get married.
Mm. You can't even look at me, so you must be in love with me.
I'm looking at Robin all the time.
Yeah, what is that?
It's a, I don't know, girl. It's just a,
you're afraid of me.
Her out. I'm not afraid of you.
I must be repulsive to you, the way you don't even look.
You have this big mic, like, covering half your face, and then you're wearing sunglasses.
Well, there's a reason for that.
Eastern. Why don't you take the show off the air for a pig moment, huh? Open up.
It's funny, Howard.
Oh, it's not funny?
What are you talking about? It is funny. I think it's very funny. And how would you know it's funny anyway?
You're not bringing that
in? I don't see anybody in here to meet him.
You
gotta go. Why do I have to? Why don't you explain to my audience why you had to shut down the show?
You don't answer to me right now.
Yes, you do, you big idiot scumbag.
Listen
to me. I'm your boss. I'm your boss. I'm your boss.
Let's go.
Hey, what's this?
No?
Robin, is everybody's salary on his desk?
Damn it, get out of here.
He hit me, Robin. He's hitting me.
The marvelously successful Private Parts, Howard Stern's autobiography on film.
That was my most fun in my career, making that movie. The idea that I wrote a book and they turned it into a film was unbelievable to me. And that guy in that scene, Paul Giamatti, when we first saw him on tape, he auditioned like three times for the part. And every time we saw him, we said, this guy's going to be a major star. I mean, I remember my agent turned to me and goes, how can I represent this guy? He's so good. And what was amazing, he played the part of my program director, Pig Virus, yeah. And he nailed it. He was so the guy, and he's never met the guy. So that's the sign of a great actor. It sort of just happens.
Bart Giamatti's son, the late commissioner of baseball.
Yeah.
All right, is this new show going to be, would the FCC have been fining you every day if this were on commercial radio?
Here's a weird thing that's going on right now. I've done two test shows, and I found, I set up a rule on the show so far. I don't want to curse on the show. I don't want to use foul language.
And, there'll be no F words.
No F words. Well, wait a second. So I did two run-throughs, and I broke the rule five times already. I didn't use the F word. And some of the words that I used, I don't think they're foul words.
The end of George Carlin's words.
One of them was George Carlin's word. And the fact of the matter is, I happen to think foul language is funny, used in its proper context. You know, if it becomes this drone, I even said to my guys, because we were so liberated that every bit we were writing had, you know, seven dirty words in it at least. So I said to some of my guys, Sal, this guy Richard, these are names that work on my show. I said, you know what? No foul language for you. You're banned. I'm now the FCC. I'm telling you, it's got to be awfully funny for you to come out with a word.
Why have you made this decision?
Because it can go the opposite way. Everybody thinks they're so damn funny using all this foul language that it can go the opposite way. If there's some sort of rule, I don't care if it's the government or anything, you make your own rule, and then you break it, it just seems so much better.
You're programming two networks, right?
Yeah, we have two channels, Howard 100, Howard 101, and the beauty of this for me, this is the first time in my career, I can service my audience 24 hours a day. We have a 17-person news department. filled with great ex-CBS, ABC, INS reporters, guys from A Current Affair, Steve
covering
Langsford.
Baghdad?
No. If they cover Baghdad, they have to go to Baghdad and say, how do you feel about Howard Stern to the soldiers?
It's a Howard Stern news.
It's about, you know what it is? It's for my fans, they are serviced the way National Lampoon could service the audience, the way Rolling Stone magazine looks at the audience. It's a full lifestyle network. I'll give you an example. I developed a show called Meet the Shrink. So we're on in the morning, and Jeff the Drunk, who has a lot of emotional problems, or, John the Stutterer, has a lot of issues with his stuttering. And we're talking to him. We say, you know what? You got a lot of problems. Why don't you go on Meet the Shrink? So at night, we have a full psychiatric session that goes on, legitimate
live
therapy, live. A real session where you're broken down, made to look at yourself, and see ways of improving your own life. Larry, it's beautiful. In fact, I want to get you in on a couple of sessions. Believe me, that would be interesting. The hell knows what's going on with you. Still married or what?
Yeah. Oh, you used to kid marriage a lot, and now you got divorced.
There you go.
You used to make fun of divorce.
I did. I did. I am a hypocrite.
Right.
I ended up, what can I say? But come on, you got me beat. Eight marriages.
Not eight. Are you still friendly with your wife?
Yes, we are. We have three children together, and we certainly discuss the kids. She is remarried. She got remarried a year later after we got divorced. Her husband's a great guy, really nice guy.
Good to the kids?
Very good to the kids. He's a terrific guy.
You know, a lot of people don't know that off the air, you're kind of a regular guy. Well, I mean, you're not wacko.
No, well, that's the key to the show.
So wacko is a persona of yours.
No, I don't think I'm wacko on the show. I think, if anything, I'm the voice of reason. I think that's why the show is popular. I think people can depend on me to say to someone, what the hell are you doing? You know, I sort of have a high moral, what some people would term moral, lifestyle. I'm monogamous. I'm, a guy who goes to bed at 8 o'clock. You have a wilder nightlife than I do.
Well, why do you
know you're out dancing on tables at Duke Zeebart's.
Why do you need nudity? Why, when some people say you overdo it?
Well, people who say that aren't fans of the show because they, you know, I think that rap got on us because when we did the TV show for the E! Network, they found that if you take the most salacious moment of the show, which we did every night, and I think that was a mistake, but we would get these huge ratings because people like to see it. But I think if we had shown other elements of the show, that while it would have been lower rated, I think eventually those would have become more popular elements. It just sort of needed time to find itself. So we kind of took a quick fix. And if you listen to the show, it's not about someone coming in naked or someone being a prostitute or someone going to the bathroom in the middle of a floor. It's why would somebody do that? Why would you come into my studio, pull your pants down, and move your bowels? Why? I mean, you've done it, Larry, and I always say to you, why the hell do you do it?
It was kind of fun.
It was good. You liked it.
I can't explain it.
He did it. But, the thing is that that's sort of interesting drama. It's the first reality show. And, you know, there was a TV critic, Marvin Kittman, used to write for Newsday.
Ooh, yeah.
Great guy. And he wrote an article about our show. When I syndicated into Los Angeles, into Hollywood, he wrote this article and he said, Howard Stern's radio show going into Hollywood will change television. You will start to see more real television because I believe Howard Stern breaks it down. The language is more real. It is a more real experience, and Hollywood needs a dose of that. And then we saw reality TV, and I believe we're a reality radio show.
Yeah. We'll come back and take your calls. Lots of other things to talk about with a broadcasting phenomena, Howard Stern. Don't go away. Before we go to calls with Howard Stern, who starts on Sirius Radio this coming Monday morning, it'll be well listened to and well reviewed, I might add. I guess a lot of people are going to.
I hope so. I mean, the you know,
this morning.
I am not a well reviewed guy in terms of my radio show. My radio show is the thing that gets the worst reviews. My movie got fantastic reviews. Critics were very kind. My books, well reviewed.
Because critics aren't. You appeal to a younger audience, and most critics are not. Isn't your audience in their 20s?
Yeah. Well, no. I mean, we have a 25 to 54 year old audience. We were the number one demographic in every major market that was 25 to 54. We have a very adult audience. That's the funny thing with the FCC talking about protecting kids. I had no teen numbers.
Were you pained all those times you got fined?
Oh, yeah, because when you get fined, what happens the next day on the air, the reality hits. There's a certain nice rush. You get a lot of newspaper print, and you go, this is good for the show. Everyone's going to tune in. But what happens, it becomes fatiguing. You get fined. I mean, we've gotten millions of dollars of fines. And what happens is management gets 7 delay buttons in, and you start to talk. And we never used, I don't think we use foul language. It's concepts. And I couldn't talk, you know, I talk a lot about my own bodily functions. I talk about this stuff because I think every person can relate. We all go to the bathroom. We all have sex. We all have seen ourselves naked and want to throw up. Not you, Larry. You're hot. But I'm just saying most people. This guy works out like a demon.
Oh, true.
Yeah. But the fact of the matter is that what ends up happening is that then management starts getting scared. They're afraid. The government's coming. They're going to take away our license. They're going to fine us some more. They buckle. And concepts are thrown out the window. So, by the way, what happens to me on satellite radio? The show goes back to what it was 15 years ago. It becomes more raw, more outrageous, and more open.
How do you react to the term bad taste? And taste, of course, is all individual. Well,
taste
maybe bad taste to me may not be bad taste to you.
Taste is relative. We were just talking during the commercials about Lenny Bruce. I mean, I remember this guy was so brilliant. And he was harassed by a prosecutor named Richard Kuh. And when Richard Kuh died recently, they said in his obituary, he went, I went after Lenny Bruce because that was the law, and I had to go after the guy, and I did my job. And they did it with such aggressiveness to go after this guy who was performing in nightclubs where people pay. And I think at one of his trials, they lined up 12 members to be on the jury who were considered representatives of the community. And they were all Christians with ashes on their head judging Lenny. And now, of course, it's all relative. Offensive to them is everything.
Yeah.
Offensive to you is another thing. I'd rather let the audience decide.
Phoenix, Arizona will include some calls for Howard Stern. Hello.
Hi, how are you guys doing?
Fine.
Hey, Howard, I just wanted to tell you I'm looking forward to having you back in my life on Monday. I've missed you immensely. I feel like I've gone through some kind of a breakup, so I'm looking forward to having you back. And I wanted to know if I'm in Phoenix, is the show going to be aired all day long so that I could listen to it? It won't have to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Because we can do, yes, because we can do anything we want, it's my channels, we will do the show in the morning. We have an L.A. feed, the L.A. time, the West Coast time, and we have our New York feed. So theoretically, you'll get the show from 3 in the morning on both channels till 2 in the afternoon, and we'll repeat it in the evening at some point. You see, this is the great thing. You know, for $12.95, here's my sales pitch, and I believe it. It's not just, you know, I could never look my audience in the eye again if I misled them. For $12.95, think about it. You'll go to a video store, and you'll spend $20 for a DVD, and you'll watch that DVD once. Or you'll rent the movie for $6, and you'll watch the movie once. $12.95, you get every musical channel without commercials. If you're a fan of mine, you get 2 24-hour channels filled with stuff my fans are going to love. All kinds of specialty shows with regard to our show. The show all the time, uncensored, less commercial time. You've got the sports package, NFL. Where do you get this much content for $12.95 and yet you'd pay $20 for a DVD? You know, people used to laugh when you'd say, I'm going to buy a bottle of water. Why would I pay for water? Well, if the water's better, you'll pay for it. And this is 10 times better. And look at this. Do you know what this is?
What?
This is the S50.
What is that?
I saw the cameraman cut away. He said, it's got to be something pornographic. It must be a vibrator. No, it's the S50. It's the Sirius. This technology is going to blow people away.
What does it do?
Size of an iPod. It can download up to 50 hours. So let's say you don't catch my show. You download it. You can carry it with you. You program it like a TiVo. You can press a couple of buttons, and it'll record whatever music you want. So it's an iPod, but we give you all the content and all the music.
You get that from Sirius?
That's Sirius. Yeah. It's great. I mean, you know, someone asked me the other day, what is the most important part of media right now? And I said, technology. A guy like me was dead in the water on terrestrial radio. I was dead creatively. They were taking away all my stations. Clear Channel fired me. I was gone. I couldn't work anymore with all the censorship. Because of technology like this, we have a complete rebirth, you know, and that's brilliant. Yeah.
Tampa, hello.
Hey, Larry, and hello, Howard.
Hi.
I just wanted to thank you for many, many hours after dropping the kids off to school for a lot of laughter sitting in my own driveway before I went in the house. And my question to you is, what was your best interview, celebrity, musicians, and your worst? And
do you have a best and worst?
You know, gee, that's funny because I have a weird sort of line on that most celebrities really aren't good on the air because they are so well prepped and so guarded. That's a tougher interview. I like real people. When I say real people, people who just live wild lives or sad lives, happy lives, whatever it is, you know, that's those real stories I think I'm best with. But having said that, you know, we've had some greats come on. Arnold Schwarzenegger was always good on my show, very funny. I loved my interview with Stevie Wonder. Stevie Wonder came in and he hung out for, I don't know, an hour and a half or two, and people say to me, gee, we had a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun. There are some people who are brilliant. There are some people who just won't give you anything, and I'm thinking back all the way, like 20 years ago when I was on NBC, Gilda Radner was really freaked out by me.
Really?
Yeah, she came in, I guess she'd heard I was insane, and she came in and she was very shaky and kept sort of getting up, and she got up quick to leave and hit her head on a speaker, and she was just, it was a disaster. And you never know, you just never know who's going to be good. One of the best guests, everyone told me I was nuts to have Paul Anka on the show.
He's terrific.
He is like one of the best guests ever. So they come out of, you know, all different places.
We'll get another break. He starts Monday morning on Sirius. Don't go away.
First of all, I'm going to kiss your ass here a little bit. You look good. What did you do?
We were just discussing.
You
that
have any
was
surgery
you in the
or
movie,
something?
Right?
That, when you're
not
in that,
yet.
When
not
you're,
yet.
You haven't had anything done?
Nothing. No.
Are you telling me the truth?
Yeah, absolutely.
You wouldn't lie
true.
To us.
No,
you?
No.
If you're lying, because
no.
What do you think of me?
I can tell you about my heart surgery. I can tell you about my shoulder surgery. I can tell you about all my surgeries.
I'm thinking of pulling myself nothing, back a little. What do you think?
Nothing in the face. Hey, you look great. You don't need it yet.
I do. I need
I
a little
know,
work.
There's a certain point where you really do need it.
I grew up here, but I really kind of blocked it out. I'm realizing that now. I'm just a little confused.
Well, your house is that way.
My house is this way?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I don't
is
even
that
believe
it?
That's my house.
That's
it
house?
Does. I can't believe that. Holy mackerel. I call it the house of horrors.
Why?
It was horrible. It was a horrible place to live. This town was a horrible place to live. It was a nightmare.
Because you were a minority?
Because I was a minority.
And that, Stern says, left him isolated and alone.
Wah, wah, wah.
You ever feel that way now?
What, isolated and alone? Right now, sitting here with you, I'm pretty isolated alone. I got to be honest.
No, I mean, when you get all those crowds, thousands of people, 25,000 line up to sign a book, isn't that a little humbling? I mean, what does it do to you?
It actually is amazing, but I think, you know, I'm one of these sick personalities that wants to bring everyone with me. You know, I was thinking about the psychological implications of this. So here I'm leaving terrestrial radio, and I'm going to satellite. And instead of walking over there by myself, I brought thousands of my fans with me to hold my hand.
Is that a need you have?
It's a need, and I have a tremendous bond with the audience. I now realize it. The audience is important to me. It's something that I thrive on, having this audience. But at the same point, it can become so important in my life that I get lost in my work. And I become obsessed with these channels, and I'm not sleeping, and I'm like, I got to bring everyone over with me right now. Like, I want to grab everyone through the TV set and say, don't you understand how great satellite is? You've got to come.
Is it hard, frankly, to be funny every day for hours?
Yeah, and I never relied on being the funny one. I always thought I could be provocative and interesting. And if the laughs come, I think I have a pretty good natural sense of humor. I have I think that comes from growing up in a family where I was, the praise that I got was for telling good stories and constructing the perfect story. And my parents would laugh, and I lived for that.
Are you still going to give it to some of your favorites? Kathy Lee Gifford, Rosie O'Donnell, Michael Powell.
I had a great idea for the first show on satellite, but we can still do it, but I couldn't pull it off. I wanted to have a roast. But I didn't want to have a roast with the usual comedians. I wanted to have a roast with all of the people who hate me. I wanted to have Kathy Lee, Rosie O'Donnell, the head of the FCC. Come in. I won't respond. You say whatever you want. And we called all these people. And they said, you know, forget it. We're not doing it. And I was not surprised, of course, because I think it would be intimidating. And I don't know that they trusted me, that I would really keep quiet and let them.
Would you have?
I absolutely would have.
We'll be right back with Howard Stern. Don't go away. We're back with Howard Stern. What do you think of one of the newer personalities? Not in your vein, but coming on the scene with big contracts, Ryan Seacrest.
Well, again, I mean, Ryan Seacrest, to me, that career is milquetoast. It's not, I think he's more attractive than he is a great broadcaster. He's a very hot guy. I mean, I look at him and I just get all
get hot.
Oh my God, Larry! We're not on yet, but you know I'm homosexual, right? And what are you doing later? I mean I don't take that career seriously. I can't. He's fine. He's a good announcer. He keeps that American Idol moving, and he's doing a radio show. It's a very safe, sort of watered down show. But to me, you know, what is that? That's not for me.
Fort Lauderdale, hello.
Hi, Howard. I just wanted to tell you that I love you and Robin very much. And my question is, I wanted to know what is happening with Robin Quiver's television show.
Well, Robin has a television show in development, and I don't know that much about it, but Robin, I guess, got it offered a syndicated show. And they're waiting for time slots to become available, and I think they're going to offer it up next fall.
What kind of show?
Talk show. She's going to have the guests on who are mentally ill, and you sit there and you talk to them, and you hope they say something stupid.
What do you watch? What do you listen? What do you listen to?
If you saw my TiVo, you would think I was a 15-year-old boy. I watch American Idol. I love it. My favorite show is the one where all the fat people lose weight. I love makeovers. I like severe makeovers. I like to see people lose weight. That's fun. I like any kind of the best show on television right now, Breaking Bonaducci. Danny is out of his mind, and he doesn't mind us all watching it. Great show. I love all this stuff. I love Lost, Smallville. I like Smallville. That is probably my favorite sort of show. I still think Superman is real. I love Superman. Anything Superman.
Radio show. What's your favorite radio? Do you listen to the radio?
Almost never. If I listen to the radio, I'll listen to the music channels now on satellite. I listen to Channel 9, which is kind of a 90s station. But I'm really not interested in radio. Although, what's interesting, now that I have these channels, I have to listen to talent around the country because we're going to bring some people in. There's a guy starting on my channel called Bubba the Love Sponge. He was thrown off of Clear Channel. Because he was thrown off of Clear Channel, I first became attracted to the idea of hiring him. And he's got a funny show, a very different sensibility than mine. He's got more of a redneck kind of show, and those guys get down and dirty. And he's a great guy.
What do you think of Imus?
I was never an Imus fan. And, it's a funny thing when I comment on Imus, because I don't know how many people remember the Imus and what he was doing. When I came to NBC, Imus was playing about 16 records an hour. And the only comedy he did was Reverend Billy Hargis. It was a bit for about 2 minutes, and he used to blow up high schools with Moby Worm. And it was this very sort of safe, boring show. And when I hit NBC and we started exploding and doing what we're doing, Imus would come into my office every day, sit on a chair, and watch me. And he would learn what we were doing. I used to do a bit early on. I'd call my mother on the air. Nobody did stuff like this. He started calling my mother on the air because he had no mother, and my mother goes, I'm not Imus's mother. He's calling me.
He praises you.
He has his whole career. Listen, Imus was looking for something to do in TV his whole life. Couldn't get anything going. He had a couple of failed shows. I took my radio show and put it on TV. Seems like an idea we're used to now. So what did Imus do? He put his radio show on TV. Imus never dreamt of syndication in radio. He was always trying to do his radio show in New York. I broke ground. I got my show on in Philadelphia. I proved to the industry that a morning show could be more than just a local morning show. They said I'd never succeed in L.A., and I became the number one broadcast. We set up a plan. When I say we, I mean the whole cast. We elevated radio. It is now a medium where you see guys making real money and having real careers.
You like Man Cow in Chicago?
No, I think Man Cow, and I've listened to two tapes of his in my entire life, and I think that he is frantic on the air. He isn't real, doesn't say any reality, and his line now is that please hire him, and he's changed somehow, and now all the stuff he did in the past, management made him do, and now he's a new born-again guy or something. And that doesn't fly with me. You got to be honest and real with the audience. You can't lie to them.
Back with our remaining moments with Howard Stern, Sirius Radio. The beginning for Howard is Monday morning, January 9th, and we will find out many things, a secret from every member of the group.
Yes.
An unknown thing, and whether Howard Stern is wed. Don't go away.
Well, this just came from the FCC. Did you say testicles on the air?
Wait a second.
Screw the FCC. We just lost Muffler Man.
Hold on. We have a real problem.
I'm just trying to get ratings.
I am just trying to run a radio station, okay?
I understand that, and I'm telling you that the commercial sponsors are there once you get the ratings.
This is a big problem.
I know that, and they're going to be lining up 10 in a row.
Listen to me, you stupid ass. Radio is a business, and you just cost us $40,000.
Wait a second. If I do a lame show, it's never going to take off.
I'm calm. I am perfectly calm.
PC Carpet canceled because of him.
We're now about to create a bigger audience. Monday morning at 7 a.m., Howard Stern will announce whether he is married. 7 a.m. Eastern, it'll be 7 a.m. Pacific, too, because they're going to repeat the whole thing, right?
Larry loves romance, everybody, and everyone knows that. He's
7 a.m.
7 a.m. I said, I'm going to do it for Larry. I'm going to talk about whether or not I am married. I will promise you that.
When I was on Howard's show once, by the way, he's going to do a bit about his parents on his show, but let me show you the last time I was on his show with his parents. Watch. Oh, he was on our show. Watch.
When I get on the air, I'm probably the most free. It's the time in my life when I find that I can really be myself. I think I'm a phony off the air, and I'm probably most real on the air.
So this is phonier.
This is phony right now. What I'm doing
you
today.
You don't like me.
No, I didn't say I didn't like you. I never said I didn't like you.
You called me
fun
a frog.
I said you look like a frog. But look at me. I mean, you don't think you're good looking, do you?
No, right. Never.
Do I think I'm good looking? I know. Hideous. I am a horrible looking man.
I'm a fraud.
Man.
What are you? Well,
I'm just as bad. I mean,
nobody's tuning in now for Redford and Newman.
That's right. We are not good looking guys. Okay. I don't think that's a bad thing to say. You don't look like a frog, for God's sake.
No, not then, but not, I weighed more then.
You're much better looking now.
I weighed more. Meet the Sterns.
Yeah, now, again, why I love satellite radio. I'm getting to do all of my fantasy shows. My parents are great on the air. And I said to them, you've got an hour show. It's called Meet the Sterns. And my father and mother sit there and take questions from the audience. And my father's very serious. He talks about politics. And he people call in Kansas or something. He goes, Kansas, the heartland of America. Oh, you know, he's got a saying for each thing. And his personality comes out. My mother sits there and laughs and cackles at what he says. They're a great dynamic duo. You can't do that kind of stuff on regular radio. You know how it is, Larry.
Okay. And I am told this. Oh, he's also doing Howard Stern on Demand via digital cable TV.
This is exciting.
We're running out of time.
Well, real quick, on demand, I got my own television channel. It's available on cable. You go on, and I'm telling you, it's all uncensored. It's all our old E shows uncensored, which you like.
I love.
I caught Larry in front of a TV set watching it with his pants down. It's a whole other story.
Thanks, Howard.
All right, good.
See you Monday.
All right.
Andy Rooney tomorrow night.